Down there lies one of the best natural harbours this side of the Atlantic, and a perfect safe haven for ships. It's just about the oldest naval base in history, and it's of such strategic importance that it is one of the main reasons that Britain controlled the Channel and ruled the waves. The safe haven is the Solent, and the harbour is Portsmouth, home of the Royal Navy. Portsmouth holds a special place in Britain's maritime history. There can't have been a British monarch who hasn't sailed from here since the time of Richard I, and several have played a significant role in the development of the town and the Royal Dockyard.
At the heart of this relationship between the Crown and Portsmouth lies the Royal Navy itself, in which many of my relatives have actually served.
As for many other servicemen, Portsmouth was often their ship's home base. But why is Pompey seen as the home of the Royal Navy?
Well, it's an excellent strategic location and was against the threat of invasion from the south. And also it's a natural harbour for a fleet to assemble. The threat was from Europe. Portsmouth bisected the south coast, and therefore the fleet could deploy rapidly and return to a sheltered environment in which to replenish and refresh itself.
British kings have always built ships, so it's difficult to pinpoint exactly when the Royal Navy started. But we do know about the origins of Portsmouth. The story, rather surprisingly, started right up at the top end of the harbour on the north shore at Porchester, which has been a fortified site since Roman times. In the early 12th century, Henry I built a keep in the corner of the Roman fortress. It was to be a base for Henry and his family when travelling backwards and forwards to France. So why didn't the town of Portsmouth develop at Porchester?
Well, I am quite convinced that the town of Portsmouth would have developed here, round the fortress here at Porchester, but for the fact that in the late 12th century, the harbour began to silt up and it became increasingly difficult to get large boats up the harbour.
The new town was founded in 1180, literally, at the port's mouth, by a Frenchman, Jean de Gisors. And it could still be French if it wasn't for the crown.
We're into the reign of Richard I now, and Richard went on crusade to the Holy Land. He was captured on his way back to England. While Richard was in prison, you know, the old and that business, you know, the cat's away, the mice will play, his brother, John, Prince John, raised the flag of rebellion here in England, and the King of France invaded the Duchy of Normandy. What were you going to do here in England? Did you back Prince John, or did you hold on in the hope that Richard would return? John de Gisors was one of those people who backed Prince John. But we know Richard returned. And all those people who'd backed Prince John had their lands confiscated, and the new town of Portsmouth, the harbour mouth, was confiscated. It accrued to the crown. They received their first royal charter in May 1194.
So the crown gained direct control of the new town and harbour of Portsmouth, as well as a new base for expeditions across the Channel. It remained like this for nearly 300 years, until Henry VII made a major innovation.
In 1495, Henry VII had the first dry dock built. It was to change the status of Portsmouth forever.
The dry dock changed Portsmouth from a harbour to a dockyard. The dockyard enabled Henry and his successors to build more, larger and better armed ships. His son, Henry VIII, dramatically increased his fleet from 5 ships to 55. Possibly the most famous ship of the day was the Mary Rose. She was built when King Henry came to the throne in 1509. She was highly successful throughout his reign until disaster struck in 1545. the French had landed on the Isle of Wight. Henry came to Southsea Castle to watch his fleet leave Portsmouth and engage the French force in the Solent. At the head of the English fleet was his pride and joy, the Mary Rose. From his vantage point on the top of Southsea Castle, Henry had a commanding view of the impending battle.
As he stood here, right before his very eyes, just out there to the left of the fort, one of the greatest naval tragedies in history was about to unfold.
One account from a Fleming, one of the survivors, said something like that they'd fired the guns on one side and were turning to fire the guns on the other side, and they'd failed to close the gun ports. And I think perhaps a combination of a tilt in the wind and the gun ports being opened would have caused the great maritime disaster of the time.
The Mary Rose sank within a matter of minutes, with up to 700 hands lost. The recent discovery and raising of the Mary Rose provides us with a unique glimpse of maritime life in Portsmouth during Henry VIII's reign. These are some of the bronze guns that were recovered from the Mary Rose. And each one of them is ornately decorated with variations of royal devices, coat of arms, and even Henry VIII's name. Maritime archaeologist Chris Dobbs was one of the divers who, along with Prince Charles, went down to the seabed in the Solent to bring up some of the relics of life on board.
As well as the bronze guns, which are the sort of major firepower, we've also got some longbows, which were, again, a fantastic thing to have found because so few had ever been found before. And I remember when the first one was brought up, there was a fantastic fuss about it because we'd found the longbow and so on. But they're in fantastic condition, made of yew and really beautiful. And they've got small marks, you can just see here, which are called the draw marks, and that's where the arrow would have been placed to when they drew the longbows. But as well as all these are examples of ordnance, we then have a complete collection, a cross-section of life on board the ship. And that's really the value of the Mary Rose collection.
And so what were things like this?
Well, this was actually one of the medicine jars in the barber surgeon's cabin. We actually found his chest, his whole toolkit of equipment. And you could actually still smell the menthol, like a Vicks inhaler, in the jars when they came up. And that sort of find, you know, really brings home the Tudor life that we're studying. The great thing about underwater archaeology is we get all the organic artifacts. We've got the wooden objects, the leather objects, very nice combs. And these are some tiny objects, which are my favourites at the moment. They're called aiglets, and they're actually the little things that you have on the ends of your laces. So I've got plastic ones on my shoes, but they had these little copper alloy ones in Tudor times, and that sort of insight into Tudor life I find just fascinating.
Towards the end of the 16th century, it was Spain rather than France, though, who posed the greater threat, most visibly illustrated by the Armada. Portsmouth became increasingly important to England. As the primary launching point for our fleets, and therefore essential to our defence, it had to be secure. These forts around the Solent were thrown up by Henry VIII, but others, like the Round Tower, guarding the harbour entrance, are much older. Built originally by Henry V, it was later modernised by Elizabeth I. To pay for this and other work to the South Coast defences, Elizabeth instituted the first national lottery. The draw took 2 years, but then the prizes were spectacular. £4,700 for the winning ticket, that's £800,000 in today's terms, and tapestry and linen if you got, say, five numbers right.
Perhaps the most personal of all the associations between the Crown and Portsmouth came immediately after the Civil War. When Charles II married Catherine of Braganza in 1662, he chose to have the wedding here at Domus Dei. Unfortunately, he was extremely late for the ceremony, and the locals took pity on his bride and offered her a drink. Only all they had was ale, which she thought was quite disgusting. So she asked for some tea to be brought from her royal barge. And as far as we know, this is the first time tea is mentioned in English history, and quite possibly the first time it was drunk within these shores.
The innovations during Charles's reign didn't stop there. He was instrumental in the reorganisation of the Navy. His state barge still exists and is on display in Portsmouth's Naval Museum.
Well, this barge is the oldest royal barge in existence. He would have used it on his visits to the fleet, which he often did because he was very interested in the affairs of his navy. In the stern of the barge is a picture of Britannia, a very early picture, because Britannia became the symbol for Britain around that time. And the legend is that the model for it was one of Charles's mistresses. So here on his barge is a picture of one of his mistresses. The barge's other great claim to fame is that it was used during the funeral of Lord Nelson in January 1806. He'd lain in state at the Painted Hall in Greenwich, and he was rowed in great state up the River Thames in a huge and glorious river procession with barges everywhere. And this is the barge in which the body actually lay. On that day, it didn't look quite as colourful as it does now. It's covered in black with a great big black canopy. But the body actually lay on the seats there in the stern. Charles really was the first king to take an active interest in the affairs of the Royal Navy. Henry VIII had done quite a bit, but Charles was the one that really made it part of his policy. And thanks to that great man, Samuel Pepys, who was a personal friend of the king's indeed, and a great administrator, the Navy really, during Charles's reign, began to become a standing force with proper organisation, proper pay, proper victualling, which before had been rather hand-to-mouth.
That force needed supplying with raw materials. During the next century, Portsmouth started to develop at great pace.
It was during the reign of George III, towards the end of the 18th century, that the town and royal dockyard experienced their most significant growth. With Britain's rise in terms of trade, the shipping routes around the globe needed protection.
It was the golden age of sail. The Royal Navy's ships needed to be bigger and more powerful, so the dockyards had to be made larger and more efficient.
Prior to 1760s, most of the buildings were made of wood. It was only natural because we had lots of shipwrights, lots of captured French and Spanish ships all laying in the harbour rotting, and it was only sensible to convert those ships into timber. So it was a very economical process, really. After the great fires of the 1760s, we find that most of the buildings start to change from being of wood construction to brick, which is a testimony really to that decision today, because when we look around, we see that most of the buildings that we have here are from that period. The clock was really one of the centre timepieces of the whole community. When the clock struck, everybody got up, people went to work, shops opened, and the whole community then came alive. So it was a very much an important part of life. If you look around a dockyard, we're very much unlike most other industries in the country. In that, if you look around, we have our own church, our own mortuary, the school, dwelling houses, a fire station, a police department inside. So it really is a community within a community.
So what were the key elements of the dockyard?
Well, it's got to be the dry docks. That's where we get our name, Dockyard. It was a place full of dry docks. In fact, we still have the oldest stone dry dock in the world, number 5 dock. And it was these docks that gave the Navy the ability to come in quickly, have their hulls repaired, and proceed to sea again, almost without hindrance. That was the key thing of the dockyard.
There is probably no ship more closely identified with the might of the Royal Navy than HMS Victory. Nelson's flagship may have been launched over 200 years ago, but she's still in commission today.
Colour party, ho!
Colours, sir!
Make it so!
What is so unique about Victory?
She is the only surviving ship from Trafalgar. She is the epitome of the Royal Navy. She stands very much on her own as the typical kind of wooden walls that we use to defend this country. She had an immense amount of gun power. You could call this the equivalent of a modern Trident submarine.
So what were the living conditions like on board?
The crew on here, she was short-handed at Trafalgar. She actually had 821 men. Most of the seamen actually lived on the lower gun deck. which was quite a horrendous place. And at meal times, there would be some 584 men eating down there. So you can imagine in this cramped, dark area, because the gun ports were shut, there'll be the stale smell of bodies. There was some animals kept in the manger forward. And the conditions will be very damp all the time because of the salt sea atmosphere and condensation running down the sides of the ship all the time. So these men were in damp clothing, etc., all the time. When you see the tables on Victory's lower gun deck, the we only see some of them. There would have actually been somewhere in the region of 80 tables set up at dinner time to ensure that all the men messed together. And of course the men would sit at tables and they had wooden bowls and square plates. And it is the square plates that we see here is where the expression three square meals a day actually comes from.
And what about Nelson himself? I mean, what sort of figure was he?
Nelson always treated his men well. He knew that to get the best out of people, you have to look after people. The point that before the battle, he walked around all the decks and talked with everybody just to give them that final sort of, yes, we're okay here. Nelson has sort of spoken with me, and it gives you that sort of feeling that you're going to do well that day. And he was like that with his captains too. He made friends with everybody, and it's keeping this friendship or his band of brothers that gave us this advantage at Trafalgar.
Trafalgar's great decisiveness comes from the fact that it was so complete. The French and Spanish fleet of 33 ships was almost wiped out. 18 were captured, one blew up, four more were captured a few days later. The rest struggled back into Cadiz, very badly damaged. So it was a massive blow to the naval power of France and Spain. It was also a great psychological blow because it wiped out any chance of invasion. And it did indeed usher in a period where there were no more great fleet actions for the rest of the war than the war lasted 10 years.
But such a decisive victory had its price.
If there is one place that everyone who comes to Portsmouth has to visit, it's here, where Nelson fell. And on Trafalgar Day, every sailor on board Victory wears a very special memorial to Lord Nelson.
Pipe still.
On their caps, you will see a laurel leaf. This stems from a visit Queen Victoria made to the ship in 1844 on Trafalgar Day.
A wreath was laid on the deck for Lord Nelson. When the Queen stepped forward, bending down, she plucked a leaf to keep as a tribute to one of Britain's greatest heroes. He was felled by a single shot from a French sniper high up in the rigging of the enemy ship Redoutable. It may seem rather macabre, but the actual bullet that killed him, having been presented by the ship's surgeon to King William IV, has been kept at Windsor Castle ever since. Britain's mastery of the sea was to remain virtually unchallenged until 1914. But the speed of change during the same period was extraordinary. This is Fort Nelson, part of a circle of forts known as Palmerston's Folly, and it's typical of the type of building and technical innovation which went into the defence of Portsmouth.
Hey! 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 Hey!
Although the forts have a commanding view of the harbour, their interlocking cannon fire developed in the 19th century was designed to defend an attack from landside. As it turned out, Portsmouth was neither attacked nor invaded in Victorian times. The sheer strength of the town, along with innovative ships like this one, Warrior, were deterrent enough.
Warrior's steam-driven screw propeller, combined with sails, gave her a top speed of 18 knots. Together with her armament of breech-loading guns, this was enough to keep her enemies in port. The change from sail to steam was significant.
The revolution that the Navy went through during the 19th century was one of the greatest technological revolutions in history. The best way of thinking of it is if a sailor in Drake's Navy in the 1500s had come on board the Victory 300 years later, he'd have felt fairly at home. He would have probably taken about a week to settle down, but he would have known what to do. A sailor from the Victory going on board a ship of 1905, just 100 years later, would have been totally lost. All everything he knew would have changed. The propulsion from sail to steam, the guns from small 24-pounder muzzle-loading guns to huge breech-loading guns. The ships would be going at frightening speeds of 20 knots or something like that. So that's a measure of it, and it all happened here. The real link with the Navy and the Royal Family comes in the 19th century, and it starts with Queen Victoria sending her second son, Alfred, to sea as a career. And he rose to be a full admiral and commanded the reserves before he was appointed Duke of Saxe-Coburg and left. That inspired Prince Louis of Battenberg, Lord Mountbatten's father, who was another great sailor. And really the tradition began of royal members of the Royal Family serving in the Navy almost as a training.
By far the most visible existing link between the Sovereign and the Royal Navy has to be Her Majesty's yacht, Britannia.
Wherever she goes, Sydney, Auckland, Vancouver, and even here at Cowes, she evokes enormous affection and attracts huge flotillas of small boats. Britannia has served the Queen since 1954. She is the first royal yacht to have been an ocean-going palace, providing a means of travel as well as accommodation overseas.
Traditionally, she has supported the Sovereign, and that really has been the first and most significant part of our task. But of course, as times have changed and there have become more pressures on the Royal Programme, air travel, the Royal Yacht has not really been able to sustain a full worldwide programme because simply, in the Queen's case, she has been required to be in many places too quickly. That particular role, which in the 50s and the 60s became a very dominant part, became less towards the end of the 70s, and by the 80s and now into the 90s, we've seen the dual role appear, which is the commercial use of Britannia in support of the monarch, but obviously, of course, in support of the country as a whole. And it's that second role now that fills some of the gap that was left. But I think overall, Britannia, throughout her life, has had this terrific usage. Statistically, she has travelled once around the world in every year of her commission. Every time we go into Portsmouth, there's a great welcome for us, and I know always amongst them are large numbers of the families as well as people around who are watching this great ship coming back into her home port.
At least once a year, Her Majesty embarks on Britannia in Portsmouth and takes the opportunity to meet the families of the sailors of the Royal Yacht. Britannia, as the Royal Yacht for the last 40 years, has been the symbol of Britain as a maritime nation, maintaining our strong naval and seafaring tradition.
However, even this glorious chapter in the story of the Crown, the Royal Navy and Portsmouth is drawing to a close. For 1997 is to be Britannia's final year serving Queen Elizabeth II. We've hardly scratched the surface of the story of this historic place, its ships and its association with the Crown. Its close involvement with both the Army and the Navy has meant that its growth has been anything but smooth or steady, invariably thriving in times of war. It's a place of which it was once said, "In times of peace, the grass grows in Portsmouth streets."